God's desire that all of us would come to the knowledge of who he is. Not only come to the knowledge of who he is, but that all of us would resolve that for God I live. Y'all ain't seen it. For God I will die. God is a gentle spirit, and God is a God of choice. Amen. Folks say, well, he's a pro-life. He is, but he's also a God of choice. That was him that said, behold, I set before you this day life and death. I would rather that you choose life. Praise the Lord. It was him that said, behold, I set even before you good and evil. My desire is that you would choose good, but nevertheless, you have a right to choose evil. Praise the Lord. But in everything, there are consequences. God have even declared concerning his word that if you be willing and obedient, you can eat the good of the land. That is, if you would obey God and heed to the words that God have given. That is, God will make ways for you when you can't see your own way. This God has promised that he'll make a way for you.
Amen.
Promise that we will live for him. We don't have to try to figure it out and work it out and solve it. We would have the right to just put it in God's hands. Wait for him to work it out. We must first know that the God we speak of is real. I know the realness, or I know the realness of God in reading the book of Job, when God, after Job's ordeal, and Job and his friends arguing and questioning God, and God comes face to face with Job and said to him, Job, where are you? And I frame the word. Hallelujah. Where were you? Who, he said, drew the line to measure earth to make sure it fit where I was putting it. Y'all understand that? He says to him, where were you when I put the door and caused the sea and the ocean to settle my place? You got it right. So you said the question, God. Praise the Lord. Cause you don't understand it, that means it's not real. I know of a lot of things I don't understand, but I don't doubt the realness. Amen. I just said, Lord, help me to understand. You understand that. Amen. This God who have created us have a desire that we would live a life in fellowship with him. You to know that he created every beast of the field, every fowl of the air, every fish in the sea. But none of them were created in the image of the likeness of God.
Amen.
God had created every other beast, every other creature. The divine counsel said, let us make man in our own image. According to our likeness. And having spoken everything else into existence. Y'all better hear this. God spoke everything else into existence. You understand? He said, when he said, let there be light, there was light. He didn't get no coals, he didn't get no power poles, he didn't get no power meters. He simply said, let there be light.
God
said there was light. Praise the Lord. But when he got ready to create man, y'all better say that. He put some effort into creating man. Bible says he didn't speak man into existence, but rather he created him, he formed him. a living soul. The fish were breathing, but they were not living souls. The fowl was breathing, but it wasn't living souls. It was not created in his image. It was not created in his likeness. He created all of these things for us. But then he created us for him. Y'all understand? He created the fowls, the fish, and the beasts of the field for our glory, for our enjoyment, and gave us dominion over them. But he created us for his good pleasure, for his joy, for his Then God knew that by specific design,
yes,
that a man was simply dust without him breathing the breath of life into him. That from then on, man would be dependent on God. That no matter how strong man got, that would still be a need for God. Y'all understand? No matter how rich man got, that would still be a need for God. No matter how many friends man had, there's still a great need for God. No matter what man possessed, without God, said, without God, I would be nothing. I acknowledge that without God, I would fail. Without him, my life would be drifting like a ship that don't have a sail. And we must understand that by design, God have created man in a way that man has an ultimate need for a power that is greater than him. And God is the greatest power. And God can fulfill every need. And in psychology, somebody named Maslow created what he called a hierarchy of needs. And in that, he said that everybody has a need to feel loved. You understand, everybody has a need to be fed, to have a place to sleep. You understand? And all of these things, and I think that that was a good attempt in trying to describe the frailty of man. I think that was a great effort in trying to describe what man really is like. But I have to go a step farther and say that no matter how much of my Maslow's need a man has, if he don't have God, he's still lacking something. For there are millionaires who have friends. There are millionaires who have homes. There are millionaires who have plenty to eat. There are millionaires who really did feel love. But because they didn't have God, because there was a void in their heart, for some reason they couldn't get no satisfaction and wound up killing themselves because they couldn't put their finger on what they really needed. And some of us are thinking that if I just had me $1 million, if I just had a little more money,